welcome to this week's episode of Radiant Kids TV. I'm so glad that you've tuned in with us. This week we are learning about when Jesus walked on water, and I can't wait to tell you more about it. So stay tuned, because here we go.
Hi, Radiant Kids, stand up on your feet, it's time to sing.
Now, as I mentioned earlier, our story this week is about Jesus walking on water, and I want you all to try something. Can you please stand up on your feet? Now, I want to see what it would look like for you to walk on a sidewalk. What would that look like? Just probably normal walking. Now imagine that you are walking on quicksand. What does that look like? What about really slippery ice? My kids are trying it right now, and that's the sounds that you hear. What if you had to walk up a really steep hill? What would that look like? And now, what if you tried to walk on water? Would that even be possible? I don't think it would. Humans struggle to walk on some surfaces, like slippery things or hills that are too steep. One thing that we cannot walk on is water. Our bodies are much too dense, and our feet will push right through the surface. But let's watch and learn about when Jesus did exactly that.
Jesus had been teaching crowds of people by the Sea of Galilee. It was getting late, so he told his disciples to get into the boat and go to the other side of the sea. Jesus sent the crowds away and went up on the mountain to pray by himself. That evening, the boat was far from the shore. The wind blew and the waves tossed the boat around. Jesus was still on the mountain alone. Around 3 a.m, Jesus came toward his disciples walking on the sea. When the disciples saw Jesus, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they cried. Right away, Jesus spoke to them, "Have courage, it's me. Do not be afraid." Peter answered, "Lord, if it really is you, tell me to come to you on the water." So Jesus said, "Come." Peter got out of the boat and started walking on the water toward Jesus. But when Peter saw how strongly the wind was blowing, he was afraid. Peter began to sink. "Lord, save me," he cried. Jesus reached out his hand and grabbed Peter. Jesus said, "You have little faith. Why do you doubt?" They got into the boat and the wind stopped. Then everyone in the boat worshiped Jesus and said, "Truly, you are the Son of God." Jesus proved that he can be trusted. His miracles, teaching, death, and resurrection show that he is who he says he is. Only Jesus can save us when we look to him in faith.
I love that story. Jesus showed that he is God by walking on water. Not only was this something miraculous that could only happen by God's power, it was also a picture of God's love for us. Jesus did not walk away from danger. He walked right into it. He strolled into the middle of the storm to be with his disciples. Now, I'd like us to review our big picture question, and that is, why did Jesus perform miracles? And the answer is, Jesus performed miracles to glorify God, to show he is the Son of God, and to care for people. Do you see how Jesus did those things while he was walking on water? Why don't you talk about that with your parents or loved grown-ups today and see how you can pick out in the story the way that Jesus was doing those things as he walked on water. Now let's stay tuned for questions from kids.
Hi there, I'm Pastor Brian, and it's time for Questions from Kids. Julia from East Orange, New Jersey asks,
"How can I have a stronger faith?"
Oh, Julia, that is a question we all need to keep asking ourselves. Great question. So here's the thing. We know that faith needs to be grown. It's kind of like a muscle. Some people have called it a muscle that you have to keep exercising and stretching it so it grows and becomes stronger. And so how do we do that? Well, there are a few ways that we can do that. The first one I can think of is by spending more time in the Bible. The more we read the Bible, the more we study it, the more we understand who God is, the way he works, the greater confidence we have in Him. We know how we're to live. And so reading the Bible is perhaps one of the greatest ways you can grow in your faith. Other ways are prayer, talking with God, asking Him to grow you, asking Him to help you learn and to live on faith. Another way is by worshiping, being part of a church. This is why it's so important that we're part of a family of faith and we gather regularly and worship together and study together and talk through these things, learn from one another. But all these things lead us to this one idea that I think is really important you hear. You have to stretch your faith. You have to put yourself in positions that are uncomfortable at times to grow in that faith. Think again about muscles. Think about, you know, lifting weights. Lifting weights is not easy. You have to strain and stretch yourself and you add more weight and there are times you're like, I don't know if I can do this, but you keep pushing. And it's through that exertion that your muscles grow stronger. If you never put weights on the barbell and just lifted an empty barbell, you're not gonna really gain muscle. So it's the same thing with our faith. If we're never stretching ourselves, if we're never stepping into those uncomfortable areas of life, if we're never sitting down with that person in the cafeteria and praying that God opens a conversation to talk about your faith with him or her, then you're not gonna grow as much. It's through those uncomfortable, stretching moments that we really grow. So I wanna encourage you to do that. Share your faith with other people. Go on mission trips. Live for Christ day by day, and you will see your faith grow by leaps and bounds, I believe, when you do that. So I hope that has been helpful. And again, that's something that we all need to be doing. So question back for you, who or what are you looking to be secure? Where is your faith found?
Would you pray with me as we end our story time today? Father God, when our eyes fall away from you, fear and doubt fill our minds. Draw us back to yourself. Fix our eyes on Jesus, who saves us from our sin. You created the wind and the waves. You are in control of everything that happens. Help us trust you. You are good and you love us. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'm gonna do another song. From north to south.
welcome to another episode of Experiments with a Purpose. And to be a scientist, you have to have a lot of knowledge. So, and the Bible also says we should have knowledge. But today we have so much knowledge. I mean, you just look at your phone and you can look up information on all kinds of things. And so that's all very good. But God also wants us to have wisdom. And wisdom is having the knowledge, but then using the knowledge to do good things and to make the right decisions. And so the question is, what's the difference between knowledge and wisdom? How do we learn wisdom? I mean, God wants us to be wise, and he tells us there's a bunch of different ways of learning wisdom. We can learn it from the Bible, and we can learn it from people we know and our teachers. But I'm going to read another way of learning wisdom. In Job 12, verse 7, it says, "But ask the animals, and they will teach you, the birds of the air, and they will tell you. Ask the plants of the earth, and they will teach you, and the fish of the sea, they will declare to you." This is another way to learn wisdom, is ask the birds. And it says here, "In his hand is the life of every living thing and the breath of every human being. Does not the ear test words as the palate tastes food? Is wisdom with the aged and understanding in length of days." So God is going to teach us wisdom through the birds. And today on Experiments with a Purpose, my assistant Victor and I are going to get in touch with birds by putting seeds in our hands and feeding the birds, and maybe the birds will teach us something. And if anything, we're just going to have fun with the birds today. And this shows you another way, like we talked about last time, to look after the birds by feeding them and taking care of them.
Here it comes. Cool.
Yeah.
Wow, wasn't that really neat? It felt so neat when the birds are sitting on your hand. You get a real connection with God's creation that way. These chickadees, they feel really neat. And there was two different kinds. I don't know if you noticed. There was a black cap chickadee and a chestnut back chickadee. And they really like feeding from your hand here. This is Campbell Valley Park. And if you remember last time, we talked about looking after the birds and seeing the birds. And this is a good way to do it. Get out into a park in your neighborhood. And so I hope that you take advantage of that and look at the birds and reach out and touch them. And until next time, I hope you enjoyed this experiment with a purpose. Goodbye.
We have one birthday to celebrate this week, and that is Jaden Yang. Happy birthday, Jaden. We hope you have a really fantastic birthday this week. Now, a couple of things to keep in mind. One is the virtual flag parade. I need all of your entries in the next couple of days so that we can send those off to the missions committee and that we can have a virtual flag parade for our missions committee this year. So remember, you need to send me a picture of you with your favorite flag. Could be a flag that your ancestors came from or just that you find really interesting. And get creative with how you want to make that, with Lego or pictures or whatever you want to do. So I can't wait to have you send those in to me at kids@mtnview.org. I have another announcement to make. And that is, the puppies are going to their homes right after you watch this on Sunday morning. All of them are going to their new homes, except for one.
This is Spots.
We are going to keep this puppy at our house. We're going to have two dogs. So I'm curious what you guys think we should name her. Send us your ideas to kids@mtnview.org.
And we'll decide which one.
And we'll decide what we're going to name her. Okay? Have a great week, everyone. And we'll see you next time on Radiant Kids TV. Bye-bye.